Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Today, physicist Wal Thornhill is joining us to help us play catch-up on a number of highly significant space science stories from the last few months. We now have a wellspring of a half dozen or so extremely significant headlines relating to stars. These are discoveries that confound or are irreconcilable with the standard ideas about the very nature of stars, including how stars form, where their energy comes from, and why they sometimes explode as supernovae. Now, of course, the purpose of this series is not merely to share space science headlines, but rather we like to use some of the most significant discoveries today as an opportunity to illuminate what the electric universe theory is, what it actually proposes, and how it explains space discovery. As you know, if you've followed the EU over the last couple of decades, in many instances, some of the most surprising space science discoveries, I use that word in quotes, were actually explicitly predicted by the electric universe. In fact, the first item we're going to discuss provides a beautiful contrast between the predictions of standard theory versus those of the electric universe. On February 20th of this year, the European Space Agency issued a press release entitled XMM Newton Reveals Giant Flare from a Tiny Star. It states, a star of about 8% the sun's mass has been caught emitting an enormous superflare of X-rays, a dramatic high-energy eruption that poses a fundamental problem for astronomers who did not think it possible on stars that small. The culprit is a kind of star called an L dwarf. This is a star with so little mass that it is only just above the boundary of actually being a star. If it had any less mass, it would not possess the internal conditions necessary to generate its own energy. While that last sentence reveals an assumption that any star, quote, generates its own energy, which astronomers probably don't even realize is an assumption. However, the electric universe has always stated that stars are formed along and are ultimately powered by external Birkeland currents. The ESA press release goes on to state, in a matter of minutes, the tiny star released more than 10 times more energy of even the most intense flares suffered by the sun. Concluding on the real nature of the conundrum, the press release states that this type of star, quote, has a low surface temperature for a star. Astronomers did not think such a low temperature would be capable of generating enough charged particles to feed so much energy into the magnetic field. So the conundrum is, how is superflares even possible on such a star? And the lead author of a paper on this finding says, that's a good question. We just don't know. Nobody knows. So while we've talked about this discovery over the last couple of days, and I think you'll agree, it's not actually accurate to say that, quote, nobody knows how this type of star would produce such an energetic flare.
That's right. For many years, astronomers have been astonished by seemingly powerful outbursts from stars that are considered to be dying or dead and just cooling off, and that is the infrared red dwarfs, the L dwarfs and M dwarfs and those kinds of stars. And the fundamental problem for astronomers is that they base their theoretical expectations on the thermonuclear model. And the thermonuclear model has the energy developed by the thermonuclear reactions in a core gradually percolating to the surface over hundreds of thousands of years. And the reason for that slow percolation, of course, is because they have to find some means of reducing the radiation from the thermonuclear bomb at the center of the star to something which is merely shining in the visible spectrum and producing heat and light. Now, red dwarfs hardly produce any heat and light. They're more like an old-fashioned bar radiator, electric radiator. Of course, it's rather ironic that that's precisely the best model for the star, that it is an electric star under low power. Anyway, the problem that this last recorded one presented, is that its outburst was 10 times stronger than the most powerful outburst from our own sun, which is a main sequence star and is supposed to be functioning at the peak of its performance. Once again, we have this fundamental belief in the idea that a star is like a campfire in the sky. You know, it has to fuel itself. It burns itself up in these thermonuclear reactions in a hypothetical core. We don't know anything about what is inside a star because, to begin with, there is no physical theory of gravity. And so the very idea of the accretion of stars gravitationally to form something that can even produce thermonuclear reactions in the first place is merely a complicated story that was invented at a time when nuclear power was first discovered. And Eddington put forward a story which is based on a gravitating ball of hydrogen gas, and then assumed that somehow or another that could initiate thermonuclear reactions in the core of the star. We're dealing with a plasma, not a neutral gas. The electric universe looks at brown dwarf stars not as failed stars at all. There is no such thing as a failed star. In the case of the M dwarfs, I wrote many years ago now that they are not actually dwarfs in size because all red stars are gigantic. For instance, Jupiter could quite easily be a brown dwarf star if it was taken out of the solar system and existed independently. Its entire magnetosphere, which is huge, in fact, at opposition, it would look the same size as the moon in the sky if we could actually see it. You can imagine that lit up, only it glows red in the case of these dwarf stars. The energy is therefore being provided to the star from the galaxy itself. Now, all red dwarf stars, and all red stars for that matter, are unable to control the light output based on a variable power input. It's only the bright stars that can do that. So if the power suddenly changes for any reason at all, the red star will change with it. And this is being observed with the red giant Betelgeuse right now, which is puzzling astronomers at the other end of the size scale in stars. That huge star is so big that we're actually able to see the surface. Not in great detail, but in recent years, the star has been changing in size, and even the redness or the light output from the star varies over its surface, which is what we should expect if it's being powered externally, but not if it's being powered internally. The idea that the energy has to be stored by the star and generated by the star is once again this view of stars as isolated objects, whereas the electric universe model points out that stars are lit and all of their characteristics are formed by the electric current they're receiving from their environment. And if there's any change in that environment, then the star will be variable in some fashion. Our own sun, for instance, shines steadily both in the visible spectrum and in the radiant heat part of the spectrum, while its power input is changing, as can be seen in the X-rays. In X-rays, our sun is a variable star. It almost winks out at some point in that solar cycle and is quite bright in the maximum part of that cycle. A red star doesn't have that luxury. It doesn't have a bright photosphere which acts like a transistor action on the current. And so the red star, the only thing it can do is to suddenly eject material, charged material, in order to try and establish equilibrium again with its environment. In the case of a red star, since the power is low, that comes out in the form of sudden outbursts. And those outbursts can be as powerful as a bright star simply by the change in the input power. It's like a supernova where the circuit is suddenly broken. And in that case, it's like opening a circuit breaker in a intercontinental transmission line. Energy stored in the magnetic field of that long transmission line is suddenly released at the point where you've opened the switch. In this case, a star. Red dwarfs flare, supernovae explode. They're both driven by the same process.
Very good. In fact, you just very nicely laid the foundations for the next story we'll talk about, which I can tell you has garnered a tremendous amount of behind-the-scenes discussion in the Electric Universe community. Late last year, a team of scientists published a paper on the, quote, mysterious disappearance of 100 stars, which they uncovered through a comparison of old data and new observations. 100 stars apparently have literally vanished from the sky. The lead author of a paper on this finding stated, unless a star directly collapses into a black hole, there is no known physical process by which it could physically vanish. The implications of finding such objects extend from traditional astrophysics fields to the more exotic searches for evidence of technologically advanced civilizations. This item has generated some sensational headlines which speculate that alien technologies could be blocking the stars from view. Now, I'm certainly not someone who is on principle allergic to theoretical discussions of the existence of alien civilizations. But for a number of years, my cynical observation has been that astronomers, and certainly popular science media, are more willing to entertain speculations about aliens than they are to give any meaningful attention to the principles of plasma cosmology and the electric universe. Now, while it happens that in 2007, you wrote your own peer-reviewed scientific paper on the electrical nature of stars and of supernovas, which was published in the very prestigious IEEE Transactions on Plasma Science. Why don't you explain, in your opinion, why alien technologies are not necessary to explain the, quote, disappearance of these stars?
That's right. In the case of electric stars, they can be expected to suddenly disappear if their power is switched off, just like any electric light. As for the speculation about aliens doing it with something called a Dyson sphere, which is supposed to encompass the star at some distance and pick up all of the energy that it's radiating, shows that scientists making such a claim have no idea how stars work. Stars pick up their power input, part of it at least, from their environment. So if you were to build a Dyson sphere, even if that were possible, you would not have a star any longer. Astronomers categorize stars by their brightness and color on what's known as the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. But it's not an evolutionary plot over billions of years of a star's progression from youth to old age. It's simply a scatter diagram. But stars, in the standard theory, are supposed to spend billions of years in more or less the same location on that chart. Yet some have been seen to change their position on that diagram in a few days or weeks. The fact that the overwhelming majority of stars shine so steadily is unexplained by the thermonuclear model of stars. That hypothetical model is highly unstable, so the night sky should look like the 4th of July. After more than 60 years and countless millions of dollars, scientists have not been able to produce fusion power like the sun, because their fusion model, and consequently their experiments, are highly unstable. The fact that stars shine so steadily was one of the key features that convinced the engineer Monty Childs that the electrical model of stars was one that made sense of the steadily shining stars and could be tested by engineers. And it's based on a transistor current control effect in the photospheric plasma that maintains steady radiant energy while in X-rays the sun is a variable star. Monty's successful implementation of the Sapphire experiment proved the model. The experiment is very stable. Astrophysicists don't recognize clear electrical engineering evidence that the sun exhibits the features of an anode in a low-pressure gas discharge. If we find it the smartest way to produce a tiny, intense source of light in a searchlight, which is an electric arc equivalent, why would nature do it in any less efficient way, remembering that stars are infinitesimal specks of dust in the vastness of space?
Well, returning to the subject of stars that go supernova, you have always argued against the belief that Type 1a supernovae can be used as, quote, standard candles, which have supposedly affirmed the acceleration of the expansion of the universe. And so, along those lines, a recent report on phys.org is extremely telling. It states, the most direct and strongest evidence for the accelerating universe with dark energy is provided by the distance measurements using Type 1a supernovae for the galaxies at high redshift. This result is based on the assumption that the corrected luminosity of supernova 1A through the empirical standardization would not evolve with redshift. New observations and analysis made by a team of astronomers show, however, that this key assumption is most likely in error. Now, the report goes on to say, other cosmological probes, such as the cosmic microwave background and baryonic acoustic oscillations, are also known to provide some indirect and circumstantial evidence for dark energy. But it was recently suggested that cosmic microwave background from the Planck mission no longer supports the concordance cosmological model, which may require new physics. So while very simply, in your opinion, why are astronomers incorrect in their continued belief in the expanding Big Bang universe?
The very assumption they make, of course, is incorrect, that the standard or the corrected luminosity of supernova 1A through the empirical standardization would not evolve with redshift, because the research of Halton Arp showed that the redshift does evolve, but not with distance, but with age. As for proposing new physics, this is the standard response every time fundamental ideas are being challenged by observations. But the electric universe has shown that we were closer to the truth in cosmology more than 100 years ago. What we need is not new physics, but a revisit of old physics.